Hi guys, and welcome back to another baking video. It's been a while since I've done like a proper baking video, so I thought why not. Also, when I asked you guys what you wanted to see, baking was requested. Today I'm going to be doing some St. Patrick's Day baking. St. Patrick's Day is next week. It's a week away when I'm filming this and a couple of days away when you're watching this, so I thought why not make a St. Patrick's Day themed cake, because I've never really done that. The only St. Patrick's Day baking that I've ever done was with some leftover pastry the year I moved to London, which was my first St. Patrick's Day away from home. I made some puff pastry shamrocks with some chocolate inside, and that's the only St. Patrick's Day related baking I've ever done. So here we are. This is actually my second St. Patrick's Day away from home, because last year St. Patrick's Day for me was crazy. It was the day that I hopped off the boat, the ship that I was on, and then went home for a few hours to unpack slash pack, and then hopped on a plane to Dublin. So I was in Ireland for St. Patrick's evening last year. I'm wearing the greenest t-shirt I have here. And it actually says Dublin on it, and it's from the Disney store in Dublin. A lot of the desserts and cakes that I've seen for St. Patrick's Day in general, it's all a lot of green, which is great, you know, green is associated with St. Patrick's Day. But I wanted to kind of add a bit more of the Irish flag in there, represent it a little bit more, and throw in some orange. Like, what's St. Patrick's Day without green and orange? So without further ado, let's get baking. Okay, so I am ready to go. I've got all my ingredients here in front of me. I've also got a little shamrock pin that I got when I was like 13, something like that. But it's really pretty. So today I'm gonna be making a sponge cake. And this recipe in French is called quatre quarts. It's like a pound cake. Basically, all the ingredients measure equally. It's also what's used to make a Victoria sponge a lot of the time. So it's quite a versatile recipe and quite easy to do. Now, I've been making sponge cakes since I was little. It's a recipe that my mom used. I've kind of adapted it to my own way and changed things up over the years. You know, I've added things, I've taken away things. Like sometimes I might add chocolate or milk, things like that. A recipe that I used to follow in a book that we have back home in Ireland kind of just throws everything in the bowl, whereas I like to do it step by step and mix things separately so that they can kind of incorporate way better. What you will need for this cake is 175 grams of sifted self-raising flour, 175 grams of caster sugar. You can also use golden caster sugar. Sometimes I add both in together and mix it up, but I only have white caster sugar here today. 3 eggs and 175 grams of softened butter at room temperature. You'll also need about 1/2 teaspoon or 3/4 teaspoon of vanilla, whatever you choose. I just have 1/2 teaspoon here today. And then some green and orange food coloring. So I've got 4 different shades. I might only do 3, I'll see how it works out, but we're gonna be coloring some butter today. Preheat your oven to gas mark 4, or 160 degrees Celsius in a fan oven and 180 in an electric non-fan oven. So I've got my trusty hand mixer here. Actually, this is the first time it's officially in one of these kind of baking videos. It has been in some vlogs where I've baked, but yeah, it's the first time I'm using it for a video like this, which is exciting. I got it a year ago and it is pink, obviously. And yeah, I've always wanted the KitchenAid, so this was a dream come true. I saved up for it, and I tuned myself to it for my birthday last year, so now it's going to be joining us today. So first we're going to be creaming the butter and the sugar together. Like I said, I'm going to be doing it in steps as opposed to throwing everything in the bowl. It's just to make sure that everything is well incorporated and you have a nice smooth batter. Nobody wants a lumpy batter. So I'm just going to add burnt sugar. Like I said, you can use golden caster sugar or a mix of both. And what I did with the butter was I chopped it up. Just makes it easier when you're mixing it in the stand mixer. You can also use a handheld mixer, or you can also do it completely by hand with a hand whisk, but that does take a bit more effort. So if you don't have one of these, don't worry. So I'm just gonna mix that on a medium speed until it's well incorporated. Okay, so when that's done and it kind of looks like this, it's well mixed together, there's no like obvious lumps. Then it is time to add the eggs. So I'm gonna put the mixer on low and then add these one at a time. Okay, so last one. You kind of want to make sure that it's just well incorporated between each egg, just to make sure that everything's incorporating smoothly. I mean, that's the only word that's going to work for this. Combining. So you might actually need to scrape down the side of the bowl, like I do. You just want to make sure that everything's getting mixed together and not getting stuck to the sides. I actually forgot, usually I add the vanilla in with the sugar and the butter, so I'm just going to add that in now. My bad. Okay, so now I'm going to add the flour in 3 or 4 stages. Usually when I do use milk, I like to use almond milk actually in my baking, but sometimes I do use dairy milk, but usually when I use milk, I would alternate. So if you do want to use milk, you can just alternate with a splash of milk. I might actually do that. I love how my milk matches my mixer. So I'm actually gonna like a tiny splash because I don't wanna add too much, but I'm gonna add this in sections. About a quarter of this. Make sure it all goes in. Keep the mixer on. I'm gonna add like the tiniest splash of milk. That's the last bit of milk. And slowly pour the rest of the flour. I have the mixer on a low kind of speed because I don't want the flour going everywhere. So once your batter is really well incorporated, I'm gonna say that word a lot today, aren't I? And everything seems to be nice and smooth, it's ready to go. Scrape down the sides as well, just to make sure that everything is fully combined. There, I changed the word up a little bit there. Not completely, because I have said combined today already. All right, so with everything nicely combined, if you're coloring the cake one color, you would have colored it already, added it in earlier, but because we're doing several shades, I am going to color it separately, so I'm gonna put it into different bowls and try and do equally, and we're going to make a lovely marbled Paddy's Day colored cake. This one. Side there. I really need one of those scrapers that like scrapes down. I've seen Yolanda Gamp from How to Cake It do that. She has one of those and it just looks so handy because getting batter off this is like so annoying. I'm trying to think, do I want 2 shades of orange? Because it could look really cool, so I could leave a bit of batter in the big bowl. I've already talked about this in like I think it was a pizza, purple pizza vlog, and this looks orange but it's actually green. Yeah, the powder is orange. Science, I don't know. So I'm gonna start with the powders because they're a bit easier to manage than gels. So I'm just gonna fold in the color so as not to lose any of the air. So that's coming out really nice, kind of like, I want to say pumpkin-y orange. Okay, so the coloring is done, so now I'm going to get the pan ready. So today I thought I'd use a small little pan and kind of make a mini stacked cake. It is a 12 cm or 4¾ inch pan, so it's really, really tiny. It's also a springform pan, which is really, really handy. I only have one of these, so I'm going to be going back and forth to put these in the oven. Because they're small, they won't take as long as a bigger sized cake. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to marble these 4 colors and make a beautiful marbled interior. First I'm going to line the tin, and I've got a kind of almost square piece here. Parchment paper that I use is actually eco-friendly one. It's from If You Care. You can get it on loads of different sites online or in some zero waste shops, and even some supermarkets sell them. It is FSC approved and it's compostable and it's unbleached and totally chlorine free, which is great because some parchment papers that you can get, just regular ones in the supermarket, are actually full of bleach and chlorine. So yeah, this is a good option. So I'm going to just kind of fold this. Yeah, it's not a perfect square, but I'm gonna fold it. And if you don't have circle shapes, you can get by them, but if you don't have them, like I don't here, you can fold it into a little square like this, and then you just kind of snip off the edge here. You kind of just have to eyeball the size, and if it's a little bit big on the, and like it kind of goes up on the sides like that, what you can do is, and I'm gonna do it here, you can just snip downwards to kind of make it make the pieces overlap each other. It kind of covers the edge of the springform area. Okay, so I'm actually gonna put a little bit of butter underneath to make it stick easier, so when I'm lopping in the batter, it doesn't kind of move around. You could also cut something and put around the sides, especially for like a bigger cake, I would do that. But I think with this, it's gonna be okay. All right, so I'm going to just lop kind of haphazardly, just any way I want to, really. Oh, it's looking really Irish now. There doesn't need to be a method to it. There doesn't need to be like perfect. Just put some good dollops in there. It's gonna look really cool, I think. I feel like I'm either gonna get two or three of these tins out of this batter. You want to fill it about like halfway to like three quarters full. Don't be afraid to like put other colors on top of each other, because that's going to be really cool. You can just leave it like this, like just the dollops, or you can kind of get like a knife or something to kind of swirl it around. I might do that a little bit. Green knife, perfect for St. Patrick's Day. So just kind of like drag the knife a little bit, not too much, because you don't want it to obviously mix all the colors, but it'll kind of just mix, like marvel it a little bit more than just the dollops. You can leave the dollops, like I said, if you want that kind of an effect, you can, but it can be nice to just kind of marvel it a bit further. Okay, so now it's ready for the oven. It is looking so cool, so festive for St. Patrick's Day. Because it's quite a small cake, I would say leave it in for about 20 to 30 minutes before opening, because it's obviously bigger than a cupcake, but it is smaller than a regular cake. But you don't want to open the oven too early, so just keep an eye on it through the window and see how it's doing. Bake it more or less in the middle of the oven. So yeah, let's go put it in the oven. Okay, so the first one is done and it's looking really, really nice. To make sure that your cake is cooked, you can either insert a toothpick or one of these cake testers into the cake, and if it comes out without anything on it or barely any crumbs, then it is good to go. If it comes out with quite a bit of crumbs on it, or, you know, the batter, then it's definitely not done. So I'm gonna let this one cool, and now I'm gonna fill in this one, and I'm wondering, maybe I'll only get one more layer out of this cake. Out of the batter. If so, it'll just be like a two layer cake. It'd be really cute, just not as high as I would have wanted. So the last one was in there for about 35 minutes. It'll be different on every oven, but if you have a fan oven, then 35 minutes should be enough for that size pan in there. Okay, so this one is now done. It rose really, really nicely. So I might be able to get two thin layers out of this to have a three-layered cake. Look at this cake up. Like, I do wish I had put baking paper on the sides to kind of allow it to rise more evenly. But you know what? It's fine. This one has cooled down quite a lot, so I'm gonna let this one cool down as well. And then might put them in the fridge for a little bit once this one's cooled down a tiny bit. But I'm going to start on the buttercream now, so that it's ready to go later when we're decorating. This one was in for quite a bit longer. It was in for like around 55 minutes, so nearly an hour, because of how tall it was. So for the buttercream, it's gonna be pretty simple. I'm just doing American buttercream. Sometimes I do Italian meringue, but this is a lot easier and takes a lot less time. I didn't actually have enough icing sugar, so I've had to make some. I just blended it for a while with a bit of corn flour, and I'm gonna pass it through the sieve. It's really hard to actually get it really fine. So first I'm gonna add 250 grams of butter, which basically is a whole pack, and then 500 grams of icing sugar. You can also add milk to thin it out. Just chopping the butter up to make it easier to cream. I'm gonna cream the butter on a medium speed. You kind of want it to just be kind of creamy and not like individual pieces of butter. So I'm just gonna add about half a teaspoon of vanilla. Again, flavoring is all up to you, like if you want vanilla flavored or any other kind of flavor. Just a splash of milk. So I think for the buttercream, I'm just gonna do one shade of green and one shade of orange. So I actually have, and I'll show you, I've drawn on my phone just. I've drawn out an idea of what I want the cake to look like. Now, it's not like a perfect drawing. It was just to get an idea to like plan. So I was actually gonna use two shades of green on the outside of the cake, Not sure if I'm gonna do that anymore. So both my colors are done. It's time to level the cake and start icing it. So I'm just gonna get this serrated edge knife and just cut off this lovely, glorious cake hump. Look at the colors, so beautiful. So I'm just kind of getting rid of the caramelization on the sides, and then I'm gonna round off afterwards. If I had a smaller knife, it would be a little bit easier. All my small knives are just straight edged. I think I'm gonna leave the caramelization on the bottom. Simple syrup is basically where you have one part sugar, one part water, and you let the sugar dissolve in water on the hob, just to kind of keep the moisture in. So I'm just gonna wait for those to dry out a little bit, and then I'll start assembling the cake. So I've just got a bit of icing on the plate, and I'm just gonna use that to kind of stick the bottom part on. I don't have any cake boards, so a plate's gonna have to do. I didn't think about this, but I could have put ganache in the middle. Kind of reminds me of like a carrot cake for some reason, even though it's not. I also do not have a turntable here, so that's kind of annoying. For the crumb coat, you just want to catch all the crumbs. It's going to be a really thin layer, so that the next layer can be nice and smooth and crumb free. So now that I've done the crumb coat, I'm going to pop it into the fridge for like 15-20 minutes, just until it's kind of firmed up a little bit. Okay, so that's chilled now, and I'm going to go over again with the rest of the green. Use my scraper to make it even more smooth. Yeah, time to chill it again while I make the ganache. So for the ganache, you'll want some dark chocolate. You basically want the ganache to be runny, but not too runny, that it would like run all the way down the sides. You want it to be a good consistency. I kind of eyeball ganache usually, so I'm just gonna eyeball how much I need. I feel like you need a little less cream than you do chocolate. So I'm using some double cream. So I'm gonna put the chocolate and the double cream into the microwave with about 10-20 second increments. It's a really nice, gorgeous, velvety texture right now. It looks so good. Obviously you're gonna need to let this cool before you put it on the cake, because you don't want it melting the icing. So I almost forgot that I wanted to add a bit of marbling on the outside as well. So I'm just gonna kind of do a few streaks like that. I'm kind of almost forcing it, because I don't have it in a piping bag, which I probably should have done, but I'm just gonna put this in the fridge to chill for a bit before I put anything on top, but we're nearly done. Alright, so now I'm gonna pipe on the orange buttercream, and I'm going to add some sprinkles. So here I've got some sprinkles. Unfortunately, I don't have St. Patrick's Day sprinkles, so I'm just gonna use some colored strands, some hundreds and thousands, and then I've got some white pearls that can represent, I guess, the white in the flag. So here is the result of today's St. Patrick's Day inspired cake. The only thing I would say is, if you, like me, forgot to get icing sugar and don't have enough, definitely grind the sugar a lot more than I did, because even though it was quite fine when I did grind it, it needs to be even more fine. Apart from that, which, you know, was my fault because I forgot to get icing sugar. Apart from that, I think it turned out really well. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please give a thumbs up if you did, and if you want to see more baking content, and if you have any ideas or requests as to what I can bake next, let me know in the comments down below. Click on the notification bell down below to find out when I post a new video. I post videos every Friday. And please do subscribe if you haven't already. I would love for you to join my little YouTube fam. Happy St. Patrick's Day, and I will see you guys next time. Bye!